Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. We are today discussing biological magnification in the module Environmental Pollution, Water and Soil. Today we are going to discuss the biological magnification and denitrification which is prevalent in the nature. Carbon and nitrogen, they are the two major pollutants which are present in the environment, and they are posing the degradation of the environmental quality parameters. Nitrogen, as one of them, is existing in the form of ammonium ions, nitrites and nitrates. Although these are present in the groundwater, but they are largely contributed by the human activities like use of chemical fertilizers in the agriculture and disposal of the wastewater into the surface water. The physical processes of wastewater treatment, they are filtration, sedimentation and flotation. Although the chemical processes include disinfection, precipitation and adsorption. Second category of the wastewater treatment is biological treatment of the wastewater. This biological treatment of the wastewater includes aerobic treatment, anaerobic treatment, a combination of both aerobic and anaerobic treatment, as well as the pond processes. This biological treatment is very effective and it's a cost effective pathway of the wastewater treatment. The objectives which we are going to discuss in this module, they are the processes of nitrification and denitrification. In this module, we will also learn about the nitrifying microorganisms which are carrying out the process of nitrification, as well as we will also discuss the factors which are affecting the nitrification and the denitrification process. And finally, the role of this nitrification and denitrification processes in the agricultural terrestrial ecosystem, in the wastewater treatment, as well as in the marine ecosystem. Nitrogen is one of the primary nutrients critical for the survival of all living organisms. It is a necessary component of many biomolecules, including proteins, DNA, and chlorophyll. Although nitrogen is very abundant in the atmosphere, approximately 78.9% as dinitrogen gas, but it is largely inaccessible in this form to most organisms, making nitrogen a scarce resource and often limiting primary productivity in many ecosystems. Only when nitrogen is converted from dinitrogen gas into ammonia, it becomes available to the primary producers such as plants. In addition to nitrogen and ammonia, nitrogen also exists in different forms, including both inorganic, ammonium, nitrate and nitrite, as well as the organic forms in which the amino acids and nucleic acids prevail. Thus, nitrogen undergoes many different transformations in the ecosystem, changing from one form to another as organisms use it for its growth and in some cases in the form of energy. The major transformation of nitrogen in nitrogen cycle prevalent in the nature are ammoniafication, nitrification and denitrification. The transformation of nitrogen into its many oxidation states is key to productivity in the biosphere and is highly dependent on the activities of a diverse assemblage of microorganisms such as bacteria, archaea and fungi. Since the mid 19th century, humans have been exerting an ever increasing impact on the global nitrogen cycle. Human activities such as use of egg fertilizers in the agricultural fields, industrialization and burning fossil fuels have significantly altered the amount of fixed nitrogen in the earth ecosystem. Now, instead of primary nutrient, nitrogen is one of the major pollutants that contribute to environmental quality problems. Industries like tannery effluents, textile, landfill, fertilizer industry, they produce ammonia-rich effluents. There are many technologies available for the removal of ammonia from industrial effluent, but most of them are expensive and some are facing operational difficulties. Generally, removal of ammonia using traditional nitrification and denitrification is inexpensive and easy to maintain method of choice in the wastewater treatment. The bacteria which are present in the wastewater, they remove the nitrogen by two-step biological processes, and technically it's a three-step process. First, ammoniafication, second, nitrification, third, denitrification. Let's start with ammoniafication. In fresh wastewater, the nitrogen present is primarily combined in proteinaceous matter and urea as organic nitrogen. The majority of the organic nitrogen contained in raw sewage is converted into ammonia through a process of decomposition by the heterotrophic bacteria. They are known as ammoniafication. Ammonia, when present in the water, exists in two forms. Either the free ammonia is present or the ammonium ions are present. And they are in equilibrium depending upon the pH and the temperature of the water. The relationship between the two forms may be expressed according to the equation shown on the slide. At 20 degree C, the ammonium ion predominates in the drinking water, and below 9.3, the ammonia is mainly found, and above pH 9.3, the free form of the ammonia is present. Ammonia, when present in water, exists in two forms, either free ammonia or ammonium ions, which are present in equilibrium in the water depending upon the pH and temperature. The relationship between the two forms is expressed in the following equation shown on the slide. At 20 degree C, the ammonium ion predominates in drinking water below 9.3 pH, whereas ammonia is mainly found at a pH above than 9.3. At higher pH, ammonia is toxic to aquatic organisms and also for the terrestrial organisms. Free ammonia in concentration above 0.2 mg per liter has been shown to be fatal to several species of the fishes. After ammoniafication, the second process is nitrification. Nitrification is an essential process in the nitrogen cycle where the ammonia is oxidized into nitrites and then finally into the nitrates by the nitrite oxidizing bacteria. The reactions of nitrification, they are shown on the slide, and the bacteria which are responsible for nitrification process, they belong to two groups. Two groups of bacteria, Nitrosomonas and Nitrobacter, collectively they are known as nitrifying bacteria. They are known as the principal organisms involved in the nitrification process. The first group of nitrifiers are the ammonia oxidizers, which oxidize ammonia to the nitrite. In most of the natural waters, ammonium is present predominantly as the positively charged ion and the enzyme responsible for the first step of the reaction use the gaseous form ammonia, which is usually a minor component at the equilibrium. There are two different groups of ammonia oxidizing microbes. One is well-known bacterial group, also called ammonia oxidizing bacteria, which generate their reducing power from the oxidation of ammonia and use this energy to fix the carbon dioxide via the Calvin cycle. These organisms are considered to be autotrophs. Ammonia is the only energy source and the main metabolic product is nitrite. In addition to the net production of nitrite, they are also capable of producing nitrous oxide gas. These group of nitrifiers have rather specific environmental conditions in terms of pH, temperature, dissolved oxygen, and they reproduce at much slower rate than the heterotrophic bacteria. They are strict aerobes, meaning they must have free dissolved oxygen to perform their work. Various heavy metals and organic compounds have been found to suppress and inhibit the activity of the nitrifier organisms. Another distinct archaea group of soil bacteria, which is mostly widespread in the soil, they had been recognized as ammonia oxidizing microbes, and they are abundant in many environments, in the ocean, in the terrestrial ecosystem, and they far outnumber the ammonia oxidizing bacteria. These ammonia oxidizing archaea also oxidize ammonia to nitrite and produce nitrous oxide and nitrite from the ammonia, but the enzymatic pathways, they are quite different. They also are thought to be predominantly autotrophic, but they fix the carbon dioxide in the another pathway rather than Calvin cycle. Although the enzymes and pathway differ for the ammonia oxidizing bacteria and archaea, but the both groups, they show the same stoichiometry of the reaction as shown on the slide. A third group of bacteria, which are the members of Planktomycetes phylum, they are capable of oxidizing ammonium using nitrite instead of oxygen and produce the dinitrogen instead of nitrite. This metabolism is strictly anoxic and the process is known as anaerobic ammonia oxidation or anammox. Anammox organisms are strict autotrophs and apparently they use the acetyl-CoA pathway for the carbon dioxide fixation. Their growth is extremely slow, with generation time of the order of 2 weeks. These cells contain the internal membrane bound organelle, which are called an amoxosome, in which the anaerobic ammonia oxidation reaction is localized. The cell membranes contain the unique lipids, which are called ladrins because of their appearance as a ladder, which form the very dense membrane, and they oxidize the nitrites into dinitrogen gas using the ammonium ions. Thus, unlike the conventional nitrification, anaerobic ammonia oxidation results in the loss of fixed nitrogen from the system and is ecologically equivalent to denitrification rather than nitrification. The second reaction is catalyzed by nitrite oxidizing bacteria, which belongs to the genus Nitrobacter, and they oxidize the nitrites into nitrates. These Nitrobacter bacteria, they are chemolithoautotrophic like the ammonia oxidizing bacteria, and they use the nitrite as the energy source and the carbon dioxide as a carbon source via the Calvin cycle. However, the lesser known genus Nitrospina, abundantly found in the ocean, uses the reductive tricarboxylic acid pathway for the carbon dioxide fixation. The ability to nitrify via the pathways involving the inorganic transformations normally associated with autotrophic nitrifiers, they are discussed, and we are also having the bacteria which are present in the nature which are heterotrophic nitrifiers. The heterotrophic nitrification does not conserve the energy, and the rates observed are much slower than the rates found in cultivated conventional nitrifiers. Autotrophic nitrifiers are susceptible to inhibition by a number of naturally occurring substances like the secondary metabolites of some trees. Ammonia oxidizing bacteria, they are inhibited by the acidic condition which pertain in some soils. These observations led to the suggestion that heterotrophic nitrification might be particularly important under conditions in some soils that are very unfavorable for the known autotrophic nitrifiers. Now let's discuss the factors affecting nitrification. The factors which are affecting the process of nitrification are oxygen, temperature, alkalinity and pH. First factor, oxygen. As we all know that these nitrifiers, they are obligate aerobes, they require free molecular oxygen, and they are very easily killed off by the anaerobic conditions. Maximum nitrification occurs at a dissolved oxygen level of 3 mg per liter, and the nitrification ceases completely at the DO level of less than 0.5 mg per liter. And approximately 4.6 kg of oxygen is required for every kg of ammonium ions oxidized to nitrite. Second factor, temperature. Nitrification is a temperature sensitive process. The optimum temperature for nitrification is generally considered to be 30 degrees Celsius. The nitrification ceases below 5 degrees and above 45 degrees C. The nitrification rate is just half of the optimum rate at 16 degrees C as compared to 30 degrees. The last but not the least factor which is also affecting the process of nitrification is the alkalinity and pH of the reaction. Nitrifiers use alkalinity as the carbon source. They use an inorganic form of carbon in any transformation that involves the production of or consumption of hydrogen ions is pH sensitive, and ammonia oxidation is no other exception. The hydrogen ions are produced when ammonium ions are oxidized to nitrites, and as a result of that, the pH is lowered in the process of nitrification. Denitrification. Denitrification is a natural soil microbial process by which certain species of bacteria, under the anoxic conditions, they reduce nitrate nitrogen to the gaseous end products, dinitrogen, nitrogen dioxide, and dinitrogen oxide, which can then escape from the solution to the atmosphere. Denitrification occurs when soil bacteria use nitrate for their respiration in place of oxygen in the air. Denitrification most commonly occurs in the wet or waterlogged soils where the abundance of nitrate is there and the oxygen supply for the respiration is restricted. Denitrification is a two-step process, and it uses methanol as the electron donor, which may be represented by the equation shown on the slide. The optimum pH values for the denitrification are between 7 and 8.5, and denitrification is an alkalinity producing process. The most commonly found denitrifying bacteria are Bacillus denitrificans, Micrococcus denitrificans, Pseudomonas and Acronobacter. Unlike the autotrophic nitrifying bacteria, which are responsible for nitrification, denitrifying bacteria are facultative organisms. They can use either dissolved oxygen or nitrate as an oxygen source for metabolism and oxidation in the organic matter. If dissolved oxygen and nitrate are present, bacteria will use the dissolved oxygen first and later on it will switch to nitrate. That is, the bacteria will not lower the nitrate concentration until and unless the dissolved oxygen is available to the bacteria. Denitrification occurs only under anaerobic or anoxic conditions. The various factors which are affecting the denitrification process are the presence of nitrates. The nitrates, if they are present, only then the denitrification process will occur. One method for minimizing the denitrification is to maintain a minimum concentration of nitrate, which is used to support the healthy plant growth. This can be accomplished through techniques such as split fertilizer application, fertigation, or the use of controlled release fertilizers. Another approach is the use of nitrification inhibitor, which are added to the nitrogenous fertilizer. Nitrification inhibitor temporarily restricts Nitrosomonas bacteria from converting the ammonium to the nitrite. Slowing this process reduces the rapid appearance of nitrate that commonly follows after the fertilization with ammonia. The most common denitrifying bacteria are Bacillus denitrificans, Micrococcus, Pseudomonas and Acronobacter. Unlike the autotrophic nitrifying bacteria, which are responsible for nitrification, denitrifying bacteria are facultative organisms. They can use either dissolved oxygen or nitrogen as an oxygen source for the metabolism and oxidation of the organic matter. If dissolved oxygen and nitrate are present, bacteria will use the dissolved oxygen first and later on will switch on to the oxidation of nitrates. That's why the bacteria will not lower the nitrate concentration until and unless the dissolved oxygen is present. There are so many factors which are affecting the denitrification. The first one is presence of nitrates. Denitrification only occurs when nitrates are present. One method of minimizing the denitrification is to maintain a minimum concentration of nitrates needed to support the healthy plant growth. This can be accomplished through the techniques such as split fertilizer application, fertigation, or the use of controlled release fertilizers. Another approach is the use of nitrification inhibitor, which are added to the nitrogenous fertilizer. Nitrification inhibitors temporarily restrict Nitrosomonas bacteria from converting the ammonia to nitrite. Slowing this process reduces the rapid appearance of nitrate that commonly follows after the fertilization with ammonium-based fertilizer or manure. The another factor which is affecting the process of denitrification is temperature. Temperature affects the growth of denitrifying bacteria with greater growth rate at higher temperature. Denitrification can occur between 5 degrees C to 30 degrees C and the rates increases with temperature. The third factor which is affecting the process of denitrification is the soil wetness. The presence or absence of oxygen is one of the largest factors determining the extent and duration of denitrification. Denitrification can occur in aerobic condition but to a relatively insignificant degree. Wet soils are generally the trigger for denitrification to occur. Nitrogen gases can begin to appear as soon as 15 minutes after saturation if conditions are favorable for the denitrification. And at higher soil moisture, nitrogen tends to become the major product of denitrification. The another factor of denitrification is dissolved carbon. Denitrifying bacteria obtain their energy from the soluble organic carbon. Therefore, denitrification is enhanced in the soils with ready supply of organic carbon, such as manure, compost, cover crops, or crop residues. Soluble carbon also influences the end product of denitrification. The production of dinitrogen gas commonly dominates with an adequate supply of soluble carbon, while dinitrogen oxide and nitrogen oxide production is more likely if soluble carbon limits the microbial growth. Soils that go through a prolonged dry period followed by rainfall or irrigation have a burst of soluble carbon that can support a spike in denitrification. Waterlogging also stimulates the release of soluble carbon into the soil and also supports the rapid denitrification process. Now finally, let's discuss the role of this nitrification and denitrification process in the nature. The agricultural and terrestrial systems where nitrogen is the main component of fertilizers applied in these systems. The addition of nitrogen as the ammonium ion is advantageous because it is easily assimilated by the plants, and due to its positive charge, it binds to soil particles and is somewhat resistant to the loss through runoff. Nitrifying bacteria in the soil can convert the ammonium to nitrate, which is more easily lost in the soil solution, thus reducing the efficiency and increasing the cost of fertilizer application. The nitrification inhibitors are therefore applied along with the fertilizers to slow down this conversion and increase the amount of available nitrogen to the plants. Not only is the nitrate more susceptible to physical loss from the system, it is also a substrate for denitrification. If soils become waterlogged to the extent that interstitial spaces between the soil colloidal particles become anoxic, the denitrifying bacteria present in the soil will switch to the anaerobic metabolism, in which they respire the oxides of nitrogen, beginning with nitrate instead of oxygen. The nitrate respiration leads to removal of nitrate by its conversion into dinitrogen gas, which is not biologically available in most of the plants and is lost from the system by evasion. Not only in this nitrogen which is lost from the bioavailable pool, but it also plays a very important role in the atmosphere as a greenhouse gas. The nitrogen oxides has a radiative forcing that is of the order of approximately 200 times more potent per molecule than the carbon dioxide, which is the most abundant greenhouse gas. Thus, oxides of nitrogen, which are the fluxes from agriculture system to the atmosphere, they are a potential concern of the environment. The another application of this nitrification and denitrification role in the wastewater treatment. The wastewater, or the we can say municipal wastewater, it consists the organic form of the nitrogen, which is present in the form of proteins as well as nucleic acids, which are oxidized by the heterotrophic bacteria present in the wastewater into the nitrates. And these nitrates are highly oxidized form of the nitrogen and regarded as undesirable substance in the public water. Although it occurs naturally in the water, but the main cause is the anthropogenic activities. The high concentration, approximately 100 units per 100, the high concentration of nitrates have been shown to cause methemoglobinemia in infants at the concentration of approximately 100 mg per liter. In order to protect against this effect, the United States Environment Protection Agency had established the maximum contamination level of nitrate in drinking water to 10 mg of nitrate per liter, which corresponds to maximum allowances recommended by the World Health Organization. The discharge of nitrate nitrogen into the receiving waters from the wastewater treatment plant will not only result into high oxygen demand, but also the demand of oxygen in terms of nitrogen oxygen demand. The discharge of nitrate nitrogen into the receiving waters from the wastewater treatment plants will not result in only oxygen demand in terms of NOD, but is also an important nutrient for the algal growth. And when present in excessive quantities, it is also responsible for promoting eutrophication in the streams and lakes. Thus, in certain cases, its discharge might have to be limited or prohibited to prevent the excessive algal growth. The tertiary wastewater treatment is designed to remove this inorganic nitrogen from the stream by the process of nitrification. When carried out in the presence of nitrifying bacteria, which are obligatory aerobic bacteria, the aeration is required, which will allow the growth of nitrifying bacteria and the activity to produce nitrate. Water containing this nitrate thus produced is then subjected to anoxic treatment, in which the denitrification reduces the nitrates into the dinitrogen. And in this form, the effluent does not increase the bioavailability of the nitrogen in the receiving water. Now we will discuss the role of biological nitrification and denitrification in the marine environment. The nitrogen cycle of the ocean is very interesting because the role of nitrogen as a limiting nutrient for primary production in the sea, and because the ocean is the ultimate repository for the waste from the land. In the form of wastewater effluent and natural drainage from the river, lots of nitrogenous pollutants they enter into the marine environment. Nitrogen loading in the natural waters from excessive fertilizer application in the agriculture fields as well as the wastewater effluent has increased in the recent decades. Such, the impact in coastal water is now detectable. The process of nitrification and denitrification, which is prevalent in the nature, they are responsible for the balance of nitrogen in the marine ecosystem. To sum up, finally, we can say that this biological nitrification and denitrification, they are the important steps in the nitrogen cycle, and they are not only the part of the nitrogen cycle, but they are also important and they are having a very significant role in the maintenance of the ecosystem. Thank you.